First of all, I would like to congratulate Souvik, Sangmitra, and the entire team for this new initiative in creating this PAC digital news network. And I wish all the success to the new venture. I also congratulate for organizing today's this webinar, very important webinar, and in the inaugural session. I find that in other sessions, some very important people, especially those who have done some pioneering work in the ground, on the ground, they also be speaking actually. Water is a very huge subject actually, and if you want to start talk about different facets of water and water management, perhaps it will take maybe a couple of hours, but maybe I would like to try to connect myself to about 15-20 minutes, and in the process, I will also like to some of the questions which has been raised. I'll try to answer them, even though I'm not very sure whether I would be able to give a very satisfactory answer. Of course, water has always been important, right from our childhood. We have been taught that Jal hi jeevan hai, and water is life, and no living being can survive on this earth without water. We all have been taught that why this earth has living beings, and basically it is attributed to the availability of water actually. So water has always been important. I often keep quoting two lines which I read during the school days. Rahiman pani rakhiye bin pani sab soon, pani gaye na ubro moti manus chun. So the importance of water has always been there, but then in the present situation, as Mr. Owink have rightly pointed out, that perhaps the need for having a clean, adequate quantity of water available to every human being has been further emphasized during this COVID-19. And as has already been mentioned by someone, that Government of India, as we had something called a Swachh Bharat Mission in a mission mode for 5 years from 2014 to 2019. And it is not that Swachh Bharat Mission is over. Swachh Bharat Mission 2 is also being implemented right now, because sustainability is important, and some other aspects of Swachh Bharat, like management of solid and liquid waste, so that have to be attended to. So why Swachh Bharat Mission 2 will continue further also, but in the meantime, as you all are aware, that this Jal Jeevan Mission has been launched actually. As Honorable Prime Minister talked about Swachh Bharat Mission, every household being provided with a toilet, that was 6 years back. So the last Independence Day, he talked about that every household gets a functional tap water connection, where not only adequacy of water availability, but the quality of water availability is equally important. And in spite of the fact that the lockdown has its own problems and all, the Jal Jeevan has made a steady progress, and a fairly good number, I would not get into statistics, but fairly good number of households already have been provided with functional household connections in last few months. But when we talk of making water available to every household, I would say that Jal Jeevan Mission, the major emphasis should not be on basically building infrastructure for distribution. It is easier. You can contract it out, and it is easier to have pipelines laid. You can always have a boring. You can always have a tank, water storage tank. You can have a tap. But that is not important. What is more important is how do you ensure sustainability of source, because tomorrow we do not want to be caught in a situation where we have the tap, but there is no water coming out of the tap, which is often complained in some of the cities and some of the towns actually. So one very important aspect of Jal Jeevan Mission is basically source sustainability, and that is what I would talk of a few initiatives, not all of them, of Government of India. In fact, Jamala also talked of, and this is not something, a very new concept. This concept is there as far as the non-government organizations and other people are there for quite some time, and that is participatory groundwater management. I need not again talk about the importance of groundwater, because a lot of people underestimate basically groundwater, because groundwater is something which is not a visible resource. A dam or a canal is something which is very visible resource. You can see a dam from a distance. You can see the water flowing into a canal, but you can't see the groundwater actually. But then it is the groundwater. A lot of people feel that when India got independence and we embarked upon basically a mission to become self-sufficient in food grains, and we embarked, you remember Jawaharlal Nehru then said while laying the foundation stone of Wakhra multi-purpose project, called it a temple of modern India. So a lot of people still think that, let's say, a green revolution was primarily brought by big dams. We have more than 6,000 large dams in India, and which is third highest in the world after China and USA. But it is not so much, I would say, the surface water, but it is the groundwater which brought the green revolution and which brought the self-sufficiency in the food grains is concerned. It is the millions and millions of structures of groundwater which has contributed so much, whether it's whether it's a drinking water, whether it's industry. So the major source has been groundwater, but something which was a solution at one point of time has today become a problem. And the problem is that of the problem is that of sustainability. Everybody knows that, many of us perhaps did not know that there is a limited quantity of groundwater which is available in the aquifers. Of course, one good thing about the groundwater is that it gets replenished every year when you have the rainfall, actually. And today, a problem, let's say, take the case of Haryana, take the case of Punjab, take the case of parts of Rajasthan and quite a few other states also, where we are basically exploiting something like 150%, 200, 250% of water, which is going inside the ground, actually. So how long? In the sense that if we do not manage with whatever, let's say, a salary I earn every month, basically what I start doing is I start withdrawing from my fixed deposit. But how long I can withdraw from my fixed deposit? And the best way perhaps for the groundwater management, everybody has recognized, is by way of a participatory groundwater management. Now, this is being talked around for quite some time. In fact, we have examples. Of course, Argyam has done some very excellent work. There are quite a few other organizations also has done very excellent work as far as the participatory groundwater management is concerned. One of the related cases, you know, is that of Hibre Bazar in Ahmednagar district of Maharashtra, where it has shown also that it can be done over a long period, quite in a sustained manner, actually. But then that was confined by and large to certain non-government organizations, certain villages, group of villages. But as has rightly been pointed out by our colleague from the Argyam, that India is a huge country. We have something like more than 7 lakhs villages, actually. So we need similar kind of concept go to a very large number of villages. So concept is fine, but how do you basically replicate and multiplicate is the issue. And that is why, for the first time, I would say, that we came out with this concept, with this scheme called Atal Bhujal Yojana. And I would admit here that to get Atal Bhujal Yojana approved was not very easy, actually. Because whenever you go with a project which talks of constructing a dam or constructing a canal or something, or a barrage or something, then it is easily understood by the people. But if you go with a program whereby there is no dam, there is no canal, you talk that, okay, we will make people learn how to measure water, how to do a water budgeting, how to do a water security plan. And then also emphasis is not so much on a supply side management, but emphasis is more on a demand side management. When you talk of this, it becomes very difficult to convince even the, I am also a part of the government, but it becomes very difficult to convince all the authorities in the process of decision making. But I'm happy that finally, after a lot of struggle, that Atal Bhujal Yojana came. And it is not in terms of how much money we are going to spend. If you compare, let us say, Jal Jeevan Mission, which has a budget provision of something like 360,000 crore over a period of 5 years, Atal Bhujal Yojana just have a provision of something like 6,000 crore over a period of 5 years. It's not the fund, it's not the money. It is the concept which goes behind it is very important. And that is why, if you recall, I do not know how many of you have seen, when Honorable Prime Minister launched this program from Vigyan Bhavan last year on 25th of December, he even underscored the need of participatory groundwater management with emphasis on demand side management. So just bought that idea of participatory other way, the mention was made also of Jal Shakti Abhiyan, which we did last year, and I would say with considerable success, even though it was done, I would say, in a little hurry. You could have, in fact, I have discussed with Mr. Raman also about it, and maybe this year we had planned that we would do it not only a larger scale, but we would take certain corrective actions. For example, this year we thought that something like Jal Shakti Abhiyan, which is not a program, which is a campaign. So this kind of a campaign should not be confined only to certain region. Today, perhaps every part of the country requires basically some kind of a campaign as far as water conservation and demand side management of water is concerned. So this year we had planned from 15th of April to go all over 700 plus districts in the country and take maybe improve upon what we had done last year. Unfortunately, as you know, because of the COVID, we could not launch the way we wanted to launch it, and we still plan that maybe if the next 3-4 months situation becomes better, perhaps we could have a Jal Shakti Abhiyan for this year. Of course, in the meantime, we are emphasizing something called Catch the Rain campaign we have taken, where we go with the slogan, Catch the Rain where it falls, when it falls. So that idea is basically what even our Honorable Prime Minister keeps emphasizing, that how to make a Jal Andolan a Jan Andolan. So idea is basically to involve masses as far as the water conservation is concerned. And to a very large extent, I would say we succeeded last year, and we would continue that campaign so that water doesn't remain a government business, water becomes everybody's business actually. Of course, someone was talking of certain kind of course, policies, but I would first talk of some other policies actually. Couple of policies, I am trying my best. I do not know to what extent I would succeed. One is that some of the policy has led to a situation where there is a perverse incentive for growing crops where the water endowments basically warrants production of that crop, or whether the agroclimatic condition of that area. Take the case, for example, let's say a sugar cane is grown in Maharashtra. There is no business to grow sugar cane in Maharashtra. The paddy and wheat were not the crops which were being grown in Punjab and Haryana. Today we grow paddy and wheat in Haryana plentily. Fine, it has brought certain kind of food security to the nation, but at what cost? At a cost where today, maybe after a few years, some of the blocks in Haryana and Punjab will completely run out of groundwater. Not many people know that in a state like Punjab, where you know about the large dams, you know, canals everywhere, network canals everywhere, something like, I think, only 27% or 23% of the total irrigation water requirement is met from surface water. The balance all is met from the groundwater. So the one policy, there are a couple of policies on that. Of course, some work is being done. State government also has realized, because as you know, water in India is a state subject actually. The major action lies at the state level. We are more like a kind of a provide them a technical help and maybe some policy support, some enablers. So one of the reasons is that you have either a free electricity or a highly, highly subsidized electricity. The other is basically what we have, a procurement. Now, even though we have this minimum support price we declare for many crops, including the crops which requires less water, but in practice, the mere minimum support price does not help actually. It has to be backed by a machinery for the procurement. Now, machinery for the procurement basically works today. Government machinery works for basically wheat and rice. So one problem is, like, everybody says that why don't we teach farmers basically to grow this, grow that, and use less water? Yes, certain things can be done. Maybe the agronomic practices can be taught, etc. But farmer will grow something which basically he finds it easier to sell and which fetches him good price actually. And that's what is happening as far as the wheat and paddy is concerned. And that's why farmers in Punjab and Haryana grow wheat and paddy and not other crops actually, even though these crops are not suitable for that. Of course, Haryana, for example, has recently come up with, last year they started, and this year again they are doing on a larger scale, there's something called Mera Pani Meri Virasat, under which they have converted more than 1 lakh acres this year from paddy to non-paddy crops actually, and for that it has been incentivized also. Even a Punjab government has come up with something called last year on a pilot basis. They started in this year also, they are continuing something called Pani Bachao, which incentivizes basically farmer to use less electricity, which again implies the less water, groundwater exploitation. And whatever he saves in terms of electricity, he is paid for by the government. Even government of Maharashtra has gone for what is called basically they want to convert every sugarcane field with a micro irrigation over a period of 3 years or so. So certain initiatives has been taken, but I'm convinced that the water sector reforms, if we want it starts with agriculture sector reform. We have to have basically certain kinds of tweaking of either free policy for the free electricity or highly subsidized policy. We also need to tweak in a policy relating to procurement, and so that how do we incentivize procurement of less water consuming crops compared to what they call generally a water guzzler actually crops, even though they are not really a water guzzler crop. So this couple of the policy now, of course, a few policy also are required, and maybe here, since this was raised by Mr. Raman, I would like to clarify only one or two things. One is about, I do agree that there is a problem of reliable data in the public domain related to the water. A lot of data is getting collected right now, and those data, of course, sits on different platforms right now, whether maybe some data could be with CWC, some data could be State Water Resource Department, some data could be with let's say Central Pollution Control Board, some data would be at different places, ground Central Groundwater Board. So we have initiated, of course, I wouldn't say that we have gone implemented fully, but we, for the first time, we brought something called a National Water Informatics Center, NWIC. And one of the major functions, basically, it has twofold functions of NWIC. One is that all the data, basically, whether it's central agencies' data, IMD data, CWC data, CPW data, CGWA data, or whether the state data, they all sit basically at one platform, and that is NWIC. Already, a lot of data has been populated. The data population thing is going on right now. And at the same time, we have also started working because data per se is not the end in itself. What is needed is basically based on those data, decision support system. So we have started working on decision support system based on the data. So that's also NWIC is doing actually. So that's the data part was there. Perhaps there is not enough time because I think there are some state representative and some district representatives who would be speaking later. But I must say that it is not that it's only a central government initiative like Jal Jeevan Mission or Swachh Bharat Mission or Namami Gange or Atal Bhujal Yojana. Almost all states today have realized the importance of water, and a lot of initiatives have been taken. The latest initiative last year was by government of Bihar, where they have taken up this what is called a Jal Jeevan Haryali Mission, a mission with about almost 24,000 crores of funding. And whereby the major basically emphasis on is on reviving the traditional water bodies. And someone talked about, we keep saying that we have a very glorious tradition of water harvesting. Everybody talks of how beautiful step wells we had all over the country, especially in those areas where water was scarce actually. We have big tanks, we have big water bodies, we have big lakes actually. Unfortunately, over a period of time, we have allowed them to kind of deteriorate or vanish. So there is a movement right now to bring back traditional water bodies. For example, Jal Jeevan Haryali Mission of Bihar, I told you, let's say Mission Kakatiya in Telangana or similar kind of things. For example, in Maharashtra, we have Jal Jeevan Shivar, or in Rajasthan, we have Mukhyamantri Jal Swablamban Abhiyan. All of them basically focus on traditional water body revival, because people have started now realizing. Many times we did not realize. For example, today everybody talks of urban flooding, and if you really see why urban flooding is taking place, one of the major reasons is that we have allowed basically not only that we have done a concrete everywhere, but we have allowed is that traditional water bodies we have allowed to simply vanish actually. So a lot of initiatives, in fact, some of them I have talked in my earlier speeches also, and people might have heard. For example, I talked about Banda, a district in water sparse Bundelkhand region, where this Kuan Talao Jiao Abhiyan has done quite a wonder, I would say. And they have gone back to the roots, how to make alive those Kuan and Talabs. Or I talked about Udham Singh Nagar's district administration's effort in reviving all the, making first the water bodies free from encroachment and then reviving them either on MGNREGA or some other schemes actually. So some of the initiatives are being taken. The other area which I would like to talk here right now, maybe a few minutes I would like to spend, because everybody talked about the wastewater management. Now, wastewater management is not only important from the government point of view, it is also important from a availability of water point of view actually. Now, I would admit that in India, perhaps when we have been struggling with making the drinking water available to everyone, a good quality drinking water, perhaps the kind of emphasis which have gone for the wastewater management has not been there. It does require certain sizable investment as well. But one of the problem which I realized, because I was earlier a Director General National Mission for Clean Ganga, now as a Secretary in Jal Shakti and in charge also, NGT basically has mandated me to right now review the measures taken by all the states on 351 polluted river stretch. So there what I have realized is that we always talk of capacity creation. And that's why I use the phrase that basically we are more interested in basically a construction rather than performance. So a lot of sewage infrastructure has been created. I'm not saying that adequate. Still data says that out of some 65,000 MLD or something, it's a little older data, 65,000 MLD of sewage which is gets generated from class one and class two cities perhaps. Out of that, only maybe capacity has been created at 25,000 MLD. So still maybe only 40% capacity has been created for treating sewage. But then everybody talks of creating capacity. Whenever you talk to anyone, any of the state, you ask them that, okay, the people say that, okay, the Sonipat generates so much of sewage and we have treatment capacity of so much. Panipat generates so much sewage, we have a capacity to treat so much. But when you ask them actually on an average how much you are treating every day, nobody says how much we are you're treating every day actually. So my point is that we now should basically, from instead of being obsessed with capacity creation, basically we need to go for capacity utilization. And that is why, like we had the talk about technology and all, there is no reason why we cannot capture every day how much sewage is entering every sewage treatment plant in the last 24 hours, how much sewage has gone, how much has got treated, what was the quality of the sewage entering the sewage treatment plant, and what quality in terms of parameters, whether it's a BOD, COD, TSS, whatever, of something which is getting out of it. So whether it's a STP, whether it's a CETP, whether it's ETP, these data, they don't need why these data cannot be captured online in today's world of technology, and corrective action on that has been taken. But unfortunate part has been that one has put entire emphasis basically on creating infrastructure, but not so much on utilizing that infrastructure. And that is why when we Namami Gange, we thought of this hybrid annuity mode. A lot of people thought that this hybrid annuity mode is something which is maybe in road sector and all, where you have a revenue stream, it is relevant there also. But hybrid annuity mode we introduced, and we already had a good functional plant under this mode at Haridwar, two plants actually which we first took up under hybrid annuity mode. Under this mode, basically we are paying the developer only 40% of the capital expenditure actually, and balance 60% of capex along with O&M. Mind you, that we projectize now 15% O&M cost in the project itself, because in the past a sewage infrastructure was created and there was no money left for O&M and nobody was basically properly operating and maintaining. So one is that 15 years provision for O&M is a part of the project cost. So we pay him 60% balance amount O&M and the interest on unpaid amount over a period of 15 years every year in 4 equated quarterly installments provided. What is important is provided. Provided he meets the design parameters. So that's one way to basically ensure long-term sustained performance of the sewage infrastructure which has been created. We went one step ahead. We found that every city we have 4, 5, 6 agencies which are operating those sewage treatment plants actually. So now we have the city like Kanpur, Allahabad and all. We have gone for something which is called one city, one operator. Like all the existing brownfield infrastructure, all the greenfield infrastructure, they all have been integrated. Even the O&M for all of them, upgradation and O&M, even for a brownfield infrastructure, everything now rests with one person actually. So that we deal with one agency as far as the entire city sewage management is concerned. So I'm now trying basically since now National River Conservation Program, which covers all basins other than Ganga Basin, is part of our ministry. It was earlier part of Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change. So now what we are trying is that maybe make some of the lessons learned from Ganga Basin, take it to some other places so that the sewage infrastructure which has been created in cities like whether it's a Chennai or Bangalore or Hyderabad, big cities also, they function well, and the future whatever infrastructure we create should functions well. Now I would not like to take more time. Some of the issues which was raised, of course I talked about bit about the database, and yes, it's a fact that we have too many agencies dealing with water still in the country. One is the water is a state subject, so major action lies at the state level, even in national level, and it would be very different. No matter whatever we want, that everything relating to water be dealt at one place, it may not be feasible, because India is a huge country actually, and you know 89% water goes into agriculture. Now we cannot take the agriculture and so of course each of them should talk to each other, but then some attempt has been made. In fact, this creation of Jal Shakti Abhiyan, by integrating the Ministry of Water Resources, River Development and Ganga Rejuvenation and Ministry of Drinking Water and Sanitation, was one step in that direction, I would say. Not the final step, but one step. In the sense that earlier, let's say someone is not bothered, someone who is supposed to provide drinking water, basically he says, okay, I will have a tube well of 200 meter depth. If that doesn't work, functions, he goes into a 300 meter tube well. He's not concerned about the aquifer management, how to recharge aquifer or something. Now basically being one ministry at least, a similar kind of thing is being done in other states also. Like today Uttar Pradesh also have a Jal Shakti Vibhag actually to basically integrate some of the functions relating to water. So we have made some beginning, but still there is a long way to go. As like you were talking about certain measurement, regulation, all those things are very important. I do agree. In fact, we are trying. You know, right now, if you really look at the one functional water resource regulatory authority is there, which is in Maharashtra, actually. But they have also evolved over a period of time. I think they had this authority way back in 2016. And now they have come to a stage. So now we are trying basically to have similar kind of authority in all the states, actually. And some of the states have passed the legislation, but they have not maybe made it fully functional. Even a state like Punjab recently has set up an authority, and the gentleman who was Karan Avtar Singh, who was chief secretary till recently of Punjab, has taken over as the first chairman of water regulatory authority. J&K had a water regulatory authority. Let's say UP also has a water regulatory authority. So we are trying that, yes, we must have a water regulatory authority everywhere. There are certain other kind of authority, like it's a very good thing. As you were talking of, Haryana has gone for something called a pond and wastewater management authority. And they have today an officer in history called something like a pond officer or whatever it may be. And all water bodies, basically they have defined pond in a slightly broader, that any water body is having some 0.5 acres or something more than that area is called pond actually. So now not only they have basically enumerated all of them, today all of them find a unique number, and you can go to the portal and you can find about all those. So there are certain movements in that direction, and we are trying. Similarly, you talked about reuse and recycle of water. Actually, we had a couple of workshops. We have tried to basically impress upon the states. We have told them how it has worked, let's say in Gujarat. So similarly, recently Haryana has come up with a recycle reuse policy. Tamil Nadu has come out with a recycle reuse policy. So water being a state subject, what we can do is, because basically we can prepare some kind of a model bill or something and try to impress upon that they should go for these directions. So on certain things, and another thing you were talking about, basically somehow that they say policy makers are there, implementers are there, users are there. We have tried in some way to bridge the gap between basically administration and like of you who are right now representing non-government organizations. And I always felt that there should always be a very healthy dialogue between non-government organizations and government. That sometimes lacks. I have, of course, talked to you. I have talked to Jamala. In fact, you know the two, three things we are doing. For example, we are doing every month something called a water talk, which many of you are aware of. And one of the reasons for water talk was basically to provide a platform where basically both government and non-government come together. And that is why, see, I could have chosen basically a speaker, some ex-secretaries, and maybe some professors from IITs and all that. You know, you may be aware that we do it every third Friday from 3 to 5. And our last three speakers, I would just like to tell you here that our last speaker was Mr. Mahesh Sharma, who has a non-government organization called Shiv Ganga. The gentleman who got up, I think, Padma Shri year before. Basically also called Gandhi of Jhabua, and he minces no words. Actually, even though he came on our platform, in certain way he also did not like certain things. He didn't like that government creates hitadhikari. He didn't want to that the government should create basically beneficiary. Government should create more of our partners actually. So he spoke there. Mr. Madhavan was very much there as one of the speakers.